It's been 30 years since Perth won a WNBL championship. Tonight, they can do so in front of the Red Army. But the Melbourne Boomers are on the rebound and can send this to a decider. Live from Perth, welcome to Game 2 of the WNBL Grand Final Series. This is Perth Lynx and the Melbourne Boomers.
Let the ride begin for the WNBL Championship.
You cannot take anything away from the Perth Lynx. They have dominated from the outset.
And they are a fire that cannot be put out here. 60-32. So the Melbourne Boomers win the quarter, but they still trail by 26. The Lynx win wide in game one. The Lynx 97, the Boomers 71.
We're still going to try and stay level-headed because we've still got one more game to go.
The beautiful city of Perth on the west coast of Australia. There wasn't a single game played in this city until March the 5th. And now 1 month and 1 day later, the Perth Lynx have the opportunity to be crowned champions on their home floor. A chance to cut down the nets tonight in game two. It is a closeout game for the Lynx. Meanwhile, for the Melbourne Boomers, it is all survive and advance from here after a heavy blowout loss in game one. Welcome back. Our coverage of the WNBL Grand Final. It is game two. It could potentially be the last of the season. Corbin Middlemass alongside a couple of championship-winning coaches to take us through the second game in the booth, Laurie Chiswick and Carrie Graff. Laurie, what does this game represent for these two teams?
Well, game two, we made it here, guys. And I think it's about pressure. Both teams will be experiencing it, but in different ways. So for the Melbourne Boomers, it's about, as you mentioned, that do-or-die situation. They desperately want to get Game 3 back in Melbourne. And for Perth, it's a different sort of pressure. They will feel that little bit of anxiety wanting to win in front of their home crowd, their family, their friends. But regardless of the pressure, I think tonight we're going to see, we're going to witness some very good elite women's basketball.
High-octane basketball, championship basketball, Laurie. It's going to be a cracker. I'm going to call overtime or double overtime. And as you say, pressure, it's about who can apply pressure and who can handle pressure. And that's what we're going to see tonight.
Get some caffeine for those of you on the east coast of Australia. It could be a long night if it heads that way. This is what happened in game one, and it was a shooting display by the Perth Lynx. They shot the lights out.
Well, and they did it early, too. They really started to dominate. But by the end of the first quarter, they had produced a margin. And then by halftime, the game was almost over. The Melbourne Boomers played better in the second half. But really, the shooting display, the teamwork, the way Perth handled everything that Melbourne threw at them, they were so impressive.
They were eye-watering numbers the other night, particularly if you're a Melbourne Boomers fan in what they were able to produce, particularly from the three-point line, the way that they were able to shoot the ball. They shot a high clip, not only from the field, but from three-point land. And they got to the foul line a lot more than what the Melbourne Boomers were able to do the other day.
And that's going to be the challenge for Melbourne Boomers in this game too. They've got to do the job defensively to shift these statistics. You can't let a Perth Lynx team that are high-octane, as we see the shooting percentage here, come out and shoot, you know, three threes early in the game, as we see Mabry. You know, they've got to run them off the three-point line. They can't. This Melbourne Boomers team cannot allow the Perth Lynx to get their eye in early.
I did some numbers, Laurie Chiswick. I love my numbers, and in particular, I looked at the season percentage from three-point land for the Melbourne Boomers, and from the Perth Lynx rather. They shoot the ball only at 35% for the year. The other night, that was up to 46. So if I took four threes off them, that sort of makes up 12 points there, and the Perth Lynx had 15 more free throws than the Melbourne Boomers. So 15 and 12, you put those two together, and all of a sudden that's the missing 27 points in the game.
Right, Raffy. Yeah. We know you love your numbers. I love our numbers, and we're really looking forward to this game.
Three-point line and the free throws. It could really come down to that tonight. Megan Huswaite is courtside again for us. Megan, a closeout game for the Perth Lynx, the opportunity to cut down the nets at home.
Absolutely. Hello, guys, from beautiful, sunny Perth. The Red Army are continuing to stream into the stadium here at Bendat Basketball Centre. As we know, Perth did the hard work in game one on Melbourne's home court tonight. They can close it out and win this magnificent WNBL trophy for the first time since 1992. It's had a glow up, as you can see. The Boomers can rebound and send it to a decider, although no team in the history of the WNBL best of three series has lost game one and gone on to win the championship. So history on the line tonight.
Megan, whichever way that it lands. We'll look at the Perth Lynx firstly, who had a dominant victory by 27 in game one. This is their starting lineup, Laurie, and there's some high profile stars in that five.
Oh my goodness, that starting five the other night scored 89 out of their 98 points. And there's just a plethora of stars, and I thought Lauren Scherf really did a great job last game. 14 points, 12 rebounds, 5 assists, 3 blocks. She will be crucial again tonight, but we know they're potent from the three-point line. And then I like Sharp, Eisenbarger, and Chibatoni coming in off the bench. Really strong group.
Take us through the Melbourne Boomers, Carrie Graff. What does this lineup look like to you?
Yeah, it looks similarly star-studded. I mean, the starting group are Opals and WNBA stars, legitimate score power across the floor. Each of those athletes averages in double digits through the regular season. They didn't all do that in game one, and they're going to need that tonight. I think this team in particular need their bigs to step up tonight. Kayla George in game one was not the Kayla George we've seen all season. Ezig McBeggar, similarly, I think they've really got to step up defensively and on the glass for this team tonight. And they, you know, the others are going to just make shots. I thought they took great shots in game two, but it just didn't drop for them.
The one thing that I will say in defense of the Melbourne Boomers is not just what I touched on with the three-point line and the foul shots where you can make up a number of points there, but they rarely lose two in a row. I mean, you look at them under Guy Malloy, they are facing the possibility of losing two straight here. It's something that has rarely happened over the past really four or five seasons or so.
And they'll be banking on that. They'll have really felt that loss. That was really gut-wrenching for Guy Malloy and all of them. So, you know, they would have gone away and made some adjustments. They have to make some adjustments. And they just need to now execute them in tonight's game. And right in that first quarter, they can't rely on comebacks. They need to make sure they're putting lots of scoreboard pressure on Perth right from this tip-off.
Boomers in the purple. The Perth Lynx are in the red. They're on their home floor. It is a COVID capacity sellout and a chance to watch the Lynx win a title for the first time in 30 years for Perth basketball, and they get the opening tip. And it's in the hands of Sammy Whitkin to get things going. She feeds it down low to Garvin, the top scorer in game one. Seat falls out underneath her, finishes with the left hand. First points for the Lynx.
Seeing some different matchups tonight. We've seen that change there with the matchup and some switching defense there, but well executed again by Garvin to get that inside finish.
Tiff Mitchell throws it down low to George. Turnaround Jay kisses the front of the rim, doesn't go. Scrapping for it, Mitchell heaves it out to Allen on the perimeter. Up top to Magin. Just her second grand final game. The rainbow three doesn't drop, grabs her own board. Magin kicks it back out. Catch and shoot, Lindsay Allen fills it up.
Well, there you go. You can see the focus of the Melbourne Boomers to go after those rebounds, try and get some second chance opportunities. And a great decision by Tess Magin to kick it out to the waiting and ready to shoot Lindsay Allen.
I think they had 8 threes the other night, the Lynx, before Melbourne had that first. They start from the land of plenty tonight with the opening bucket and an early lead change. Mabry puts up prayer and gets it to go.
Wobbles that one in, but I mean, she's that good a shooter. They just can't let her get off early. As we see Kayla George front rim that one.
She thought about the look from the three-point land, doesn't take it. Allen up top to George. Scherf closes out. Magin on the perimeter. 3 on the shot clock. Now the baseline change for Kayla George is good.
Signature for the Boomers there with a little pick and pop. Kayla George involved early, attacking that drops defense by the Perth Lynx. That's what they need to do more of, and particularly if she can drop those pick and pop shots early.
4 baskets in, 3 lead changes already. Gives you an early indication of the evenness of these two teams as Scherf finds bottom from a long way out.
That was the thing about Perth last game, is that it wasn't just 1, 2, 3 players that were shooting the threes. They all got into the party, and we can see Lauren Scherf and you know, her answer to that. But nice little basket by Tiff Mitchell there to sort of steady the ship for the Boomers.
Both teams hot from the field to start. Mabry, another mate.
Wow. To me, she's the X factor for this Perth Lynx team. She started in game one. She started here in game two. They've got to find a way to keep the ball out of her hands. She'll get this crowd going. She can score inside, outside. They need the ball out of her hands in this next possession.
Gee, a missed basket. It's the first one that we've had in quite some time as Mitchell misses from the corner. 6 lead changes already in the game. Nice D. Allen had a hand on it. Perth recover it.
And Garvin draws the foul and go against Kayla George. So 8-7, six lead changes already.
Defensive intensity, I've got to say, from the Melbourne Boomers is three octanes up from what it was in game one. I think that's setting the tone for them. And it helps them lighten up a little bit at the offensive end. But both teams shooting exceptional clips so far.
Young works through contact, can't finish. And obviously, I want all our viewers to stay with us throughout the night because you never know that what can happen in any game of sport. But it did feel like coming in, we would know a lot in the first 10 minutes as to how the Boomers would front up after a heavy defeat in game one. And they're here to play. There's no doubt about that. No points on this trip down the floor. Mabry to Young to Whitcomb in the corner. The high arcing three doesn't go.
D-Trans has got to be the job here for the Melbourne Boomers. They can't let the Perth Lynx get out and run. Got out of jail on that one with a wide open three look for Whitcomb.
I like the fact that Melbourne's looking to have a bit more of a mixture of inside and out, a little bit more attacking than they did in game one.
Oh, Maglagore on the end of the neat pass from Magin, can't finish over Scherf. Couple of stops on both sides of the floor. Young, attack mode, lays it in.
Just a bit of a miscommunication there on that defense. What are they going to do on an early high pick and roll situation? Switch, show, whatever. They did nothing that time.
Young had 21 in the opening game. Lindsay Allen from the free throw line. Can't finish. Magma Gordon, deft touch. Allen loads up from three, bangs that down.
That's four offensive rebounds for Melbourne at this stage. That's really something that Perth are going to have to take care of.
Whitcomb along the baseline. At the Young on the perimeter. To Mabry, and they'll reload with 10 on the red numbers. Mabry shakes Magmagor. Shot's good. Deep two.
She is tough. From, you know, over a big hand of Ezzie McBeggars. We see the switching defense from the Melbourne Boomers. She's got the answers.
And I think though Melbourne have to accept that they are going to make some tough contested shots. What they have to do is make sure they're contested and not give them anything easy.
George's three doesn't go. Two of five early to Melbourne Boomers, so not afraid to shoot. As Mabry, a little short.
From the car park. She was feeling it. She was 3 of 3 prior to that one. Why not?
Allen to Magmagor. Neat pass.
Great vision. Little wraparound pass there. Ezzie ready to catch and shoot it. They need that. They need her involved like that, Graffy.
Yeah, the deep penetration is really helping Melbourne Boomers as we see Sammy Whitcomb with the deep penetration. And turf out of bounds by McBeagle.
Gee, quality start. Perth are 6 of 10 from the field. Meanwhile, the Melbourne Boomers currently at 5 of 13, but both teams making some big shots early in this game.
We can see clearly the coaches have made some adjustments. Laurie from game one, we see Melbourne Boomers really looking to get the ball inside deep with penetration, bit more movement. We're seeing them switch on some ball screens a little differently than they did in game two. It'll be interesting to see how the Perth Lynx counter-attack those counters.
Had 15 more made threes in game one, the Perth Lynx. 1 of 2 on the trip from Whitcomb. Early advance, George to Magmagor, called for the walk.
Right idea by the Boomers. You know, can they get some easy buckets, get out and run? Ezzie McBeagar gets to the point of the rim there. You know, a little unbalanced, unlucky to get that travel call, but right idea in terms of attacking on the break and getting to the rim.
The other element here is the time zone as well over to the west, which only just come off daylight savings on the east coast of Australia, which means body clock-wise, it's really a 10 p.m. start by Australian Eastern Daylight Time. 9 o'clock as it is at the moment, so the two-hour adjustment. That's what happens when you get the home court advantage, make the most of it, and a 7 p.m. start local time means it's a late one for the opposition.
It does. Lindsay Allen not happy with that. Thought there was a foul call against her that prevented the break. But some great pressure D by the Melbourne Boomers. They're, as I said earlier, their defensive intensity is through the roof compared to game one. And the old adage, you know, defense wins championships. You've got to be able to apply defensive pressure, particularly to a high-octane scoring team like the Perth Lynx.
Well, and I think for Melbourne, they feed off of that. So as you said, their offense flows on from that defense. So if they're feeling confident in their defense and what they can do and the pressure they can put on, it really helps them and settles them offensively.
Young, that's good. Hits the hardwood, but banks the point.
My goodness, they make unbelievably tough shots. Off balance, eyes on rim, time after time.
Here's Jackie Young. What a season she's had. Averaging 18 points a game, made the all WNBL first team. It was announced during the week. And some early burn for Eisenbarger. Swings it up top to Young. Young again off the dribble, pulls up, rims out. Scherf swats it over the baseline. It'll be Perth ball.
So you could see Izzy right there went under the screen, anticipating that Young is, you know, we know she likes to penetrate, pull up, and was able to meet her on the other side and contest that.
I don't know if you saw that shot of Ryan Petrick, the coach of the Perth Lynx, as Whitcomb loads up from the corner. Can't connect. Drinking a soft drink during the game. What about in your coaching days, Carrie or Laurie, were you soft drink during the match?
Soft drink and a water. Need a little pep up, a little sugar pep up, and a little lubrication so that screaming coach voice could stay well tuned.
I just had water.
Here's Allen up top. Clean look for three. Got it.
That's her third three of the game. You could tell she's ready to play. She's focused, and Melbourne need her bringing it.
3 of 3 from long range for Lindsay Allen. As Jackie Young drives, wants the points to count, may well count them and one.
I think that's a, Graffy, what do you reckon, a veteran move by Jackie Young, realizing that Izzy Wright's on her. She's got the foot speed, she's got the, you know, she's come off the bench. She's attacking her.
Absolutely. And one of the things that Young does so well, you know, we saw it just then, like you say, goes at a rookie, draws a foul, but she's got such a great ability to sucker fouls. You know, she'll get bigs in the air, find their body, get a finish and an end one. She's just such a classy athlete in terms of her ability to finish and draw contact.
Full court trap on. Boomers work their way through it. Wright doesn't take the look in the corner. And the Boomers reload. 3-point game. We had 6 lead changes early, and Perth have protected a buffer from that point on. One possession game. Great vision. Right in the corner. Misfires from three. And Perth come up with it.
You can see how, you can see how Perth pushed the ball at every single opportunity. Melbourne, it forces Melbourne to have to, you know, match up early, have to think defense early. They don't have any breathing time.
Mabry creates her own shot and kicks it down to the corner. 6 left on the red numbers. Young pulls up, shot up, no good. And Sharp recovers the rebound. Reset that to 14. As Mabry rolls off the pick, shoots the three, and it rattles in.
They're not swishes tonight, but boy, they're going down. They're rattling in, and it doesn't matter how they go in. The 3 points is a 3 points, whether it's a swish or it rattles in. As we see Madgen on the deck.
Oh, Garvin comes up with it, steals it straight from her, attempting to put the shot up. And then a foul down the floor on Jackie Young. So a big moment here late in this first quarter with 2 to go before quarter time. It's a 6-point game, as it's wide as it's been.
Little momentum here for Perth. Critical next couple of possessions for the Melbourne Boomers. They don't want this to blow out this next 2 minutes. They're really going to keep the scoreboard pressure on, make sure they're getting stops. And look, again, Perth Lynx are making big shots. So long as they're playing contested shots, I think their defensive intensity is up. But this possession here is a critical one.
Alex Cipitone averaging 19 minutes a game this season. Had just under 10 in game one. Works her way to the basket. Kicks it out. Sharp for the triple. Not quite. And Allen on the rebound. Is that a fine start from distance? On the end of it from George. Underneath the hoop. Allen goes back off the window. Draws the foul from Mabry.
Really clever by Allen. She did the exact same move last time and looked to pass it to Izzy. And they've defended that. And now she's recognized that and taken it herself. Really clever move.
She's come to play tonight.
She has, LA.
All WNBL second team for Lindsay Allen during the week, joining Kayla George and Marina Mabry as other all second team players. And from the first team, we've got Jackie Young and Ezzy McGregor. So 5 of the best 10 players in the league from the season just passed, featuring in this grand final series. We got 1 of 2. The O-board for George, and wrestled from her by Cipitone. Jump ball and possession arrow going the Boomers' way, so at least they keep it in their front court, down 5.
5-0 boards for the Melbourne Boomers. Huge improvement on game one. They've come to play tonight. Defensive intensity is up. Attack on the offensive boards is up. Deep penetrations. They're doing all the right things.
Imagine to Mag McGaw, left-handed nice. Layup off glass.
Little screen inside by Kayla George. Just opened up that lane for Ezzy to drive all the way to the basket.
Back to a one-possession game. Scherf catches down low, caught in a tangle with Mag McGaw, and a foul called underneath the hoop. They're in the bonus, so foul shots coming up. And there's the finish from Ezzy.
Interesting, both coaches have gone to their benches pretty early. Laurie, in this, you know, this first quarter, we've seen some in coming back now to their starting groups, but good to see the coaches getting some people in early to make sure that if they want to come home strong, they're coming home with their core group.
Well, Ryan Petrick made the point to me today when I was speaking to him that Alex Cipitone is still recovering from, you know, her COVID, and while she feels great, she can still only play for short spurts, and then she has to come off. So, but she's so valuable coming off the bench for Perth. It's great to see her out there.
Mag McGaw lays it in again. Back-to-back trips down the floor.
Not sure we even saw that in game one.
Not once. You know, this Melbourne Boomers team have made a big adjustment already. It's clear that they've made, you know, they've taken the lessons from game one. They've brought them into game two.
Garvin, clean look in the corner, got it.
See, I just don't think they can overhelp that much with Scherf on that. Yes, she's a target, but I think you have to almost hedge it, but you have to stay out with those shooters.
I think you've got to play the scout. Garvin's a 40% three-throw shooter across the three-point shooter across the season. You can't give her open threes.
One drops from Kayla George, her first make from long range, fourth for the Boomers. They've outshot Perth from three-point land of this opening quarter. Whitcomb.
Carbon copy. Veteran players going at a young rookie. Almost exact same play as we saw a minute or two earlier from Jackie Young via a rookie.
High-scoring, free-flowing opening quarter of basketball. Already with 50 points in the game as George drives it through contact and finishes. And that'll do us through one. So 27 to 25. It's just a one possession game at quarter time. What a hot start to game two of the grand final series. It's the Lynx in a closeout game by a bucket at quarter time. Let's get to work. Let's get it, let's work.
With doubt and dismay, you are smitten. You think there's no chance for you, none. Why the best books haven't been written, the best race hasn't been run, the best tune hasn't been played yet. Cheer up, for the world is young. For the best jobs haven't been started, the best work hasn't been done.
Moment for your next career step? Can you have a stellar career filled with passion? Yes, but it all starts with you. Get experience connected and ready with mid-year entry at the University of Canberra.
One quarter down in game two of the grand final series, a closeout game for the Perth Lynx, while for the Melbourne Boomers it survived and advanced from here. A single possession game, it's 28 to 25. So we did say 27 to 25 before the break, but that Darcy Garvin three from the corner reviewed, and it was all three. So still a single possession game, but a highly entertaining opening quarter.
Well, both teams, I thought, really settled into the game very quickly, you know, made some key shots, made some key adjustments from game one. Certainly the Melbourne Boomers did, and really took care of the basketball.
Megan Haswaite was in the Perth huddle. What did you pick up, Megan?
Ryan Patrick, happy with the offense, but a bit of work to do defensively. They knew that Lindsay Allen was going to come out and have a bit of a say for the Boomers, as she certainly has done in the first quarter. They're looking to lock down on her in this second term.
Lynx have five different scorers, all with three or more points. Meanwhile, for the Melbourne Boomers, they have three players responsible for 23 of their 25 points, as Mabry with a turnaround jumper doesn't go. So 10 for Allen, 7 for George, and 6 for Ezzy. This is George up top. Three-time WNBL champion already. Imagine looking for her first. Jump shot doesn't go, and strong rebound for Sammy Whitcomb.
Just looking a little tight, Tess Madgen, on those mid-range jumpers. But I've got to say, Melbourne Boomers ball movement, player movement is spot on.
Doesn't get the shooter's roll. Nice work again from Sammy Whitcomb. Can just always create her own shot on the floor. Mitchell gets around Mabry. Kicks it out. Imagine. Extra pass. George up top for three. Rims out. And Chibatoni the rebound.
Melbourne's still a bit stagnant, I think, on that last offensive set. They just stood there, let the Perth Pack defense set up as they liked, as Scherf misses the turnaround, Jay.
Three-point game. Six early lead changes in it. And Perth have been able to protect a small margin from there on, as wide as it got, with 6 points at one stage in the first. They swing it around the horn. Maglagore, deep two, rims out. And Whitcomb scrapping for it along the baseline. Eventually, Garvin controls the handle. Played just the five games here this year, Perth. Obviously, their season was delayed. They didn't start until the new year. They had to spend the first, what they thought was going to be, month on the road. It turned out to be a lot longer than that. Based out of Ballarat, as Chibatoni puts up a turnaround jumper, can't finish, Scherf does. And in the end, it's the five games at the Bendat Basketball Centre for three wins and a couple of losses. And now a grand final game here. Three more for Kayla George, hits it up top.
Signature pick and pop. She loves that shot. Top of the key three-point range, off the pick and pop. And she's engaged in this game, as we see her not foul.
That's
against Sammy Whitcomb, but you know, the star players find a way to make big plays. That was an unbelievable finish from Sammy Whitcomb.
Spectacular finish. And Whitcomb absolutely looks up for this, a chance to become a WNBL champion. What a story she's had in her history with the Perth Lynx out of the State League, and now a naturalised Aussie, as Scherf defends the jumper well from Maglagore.
Don't think Ezzy really needed to rush quite as much as she did. There was still time on the clock for her to, you know, maybe up fake or step through something a little bit more aggressive.
Mabry feints to pass, can't finish at the hoop.
This is where I'd like to see Melbourne really push it. She's down on the ground.
Oh, no. Wright had a foot on the baseline on the way through, so they hand bank possession. And now Izzy Wright will take a seat. She spent a year with Perth a few seasons back. Just see the heel on the baseline. Good call from the ref. In possession for Perth, up four.
I like to see here, you know, next offensive possession for Melbourne Boomers, go at Mabry. You know, she's a bit of frustration showing for her now. She's front rimmed a couple of shots, not happy. When, you know, a play like that can get a little, you know, light off the handle and see if they can draw a cheap foul.
There's a heel on the sideline, of course, from Izzy Wright. Oh, nice work. Kayla George picks the pocket of Garvin. Swings it to Davidson. Up top for Allen. She's 3 of 3 from long range. Takes it all the way to the hoop, but swatted away. Eisenbarger.
Great
that
timing.
Shot out of here.
She made that look so easy, but the timing of that block was fantastic.
Young back on the floor. Goes left-handed. Through the hands. Can't finish.
LA now controlling the tempo for the Boomers. Smart play, I think. Just get him regathered, see if they can get, she can get some ball screen action again with Kayla George.
George for three. Off the front of the rim. Sharp tries to pull down the rebound, can't quite. Allen along the baseline.
Wow. Lindsay Allen just testing the waters there, and then a quick hesitation and a reverse layup.
She's up to 12, leads all scorers. Looks the biggest threat offensively on the floor at the moment for the Boomers. Young at the other end. Trying to work through the lane, draws the double team, draws the foul.
Kelly George probably didn't need to get her hands in there. Great hesitation by LA.
It's a good plan to have a taller defender in Magin on Young as opposed to LA, because she does like to post up opposition, taller, smaller players.
Oh, Wickham, the Eurostep shook Allen, then finishes.
All class, Sammy Wickham.
What a night she's having. Mitchell combines with Davidson, count them, and one.
Melbourne Boomers execution on this, on their ball screen, is first as we see Sammy Wickham find a finish, regathers. Mitchell straight back at you with a little dump inside to Davidson for the finish. Well executed on their ball screens, their two-man games. They're really forcing rotation from this Perth Lynx defensive team.
Davidson hits the and one.
This is the sort of game we expected in a grand final game. A one-point game, 5 minutes left in this second quarter.
Big shots from big players in big games.
Exactly.
Intense D. Possession game, pretty tough from both teams.
Young with 7, Mabry with 9, the leading scorers for the Lynx. This is Young off the dribble, pulls up for 3, it's a little long. Hustling after the rebound, Tiff Mitchell comes up with it.
Guy Malloy will be happy, I think, with his the defensive effort of his team. Not just in their intensity, but it looks like they're following the game plan. You know, they've got different schemes for the ball screen D. They're defending appropriately on most of the scouts individually. I think he's got to be pretty happy with what they're doing defensively, given still that both teams are shooting a pretty good clip and making tough shots against tough defense.
Right on cue, carry as George forces a turnover. Bounce pass through to Allen, trying to finish at the hoop. Draws the foul. He caught on Scherf and Lindsay Allen. Could add to her 12 points at the free throw line. How's this stop from Kayla George? Great anticipation.
Isn't she engaged in this game? I mean, LA's come to play. Kayla George has come to play. You know, those two in particular are different players than we saw, you know, just a few nights ago.
You see Guy Malloy, the coach of the Boomers, top of your screen. There's so many subplots to any grand final series. He could be coaching his last game for Melbourne. This is his 9th and final season in charge of the Boomers. They've made a grand final series previously. This is their 2nd under his tutelage. Looking for his first title. Allen to put the Boomers back in front. She does. What a night she's having. She's up to 14 points. 7th lead change in the game. First of his 2nd quarter. Young gets the lead straight back, and the foul to follow from Magin, and Jackie Young to the line.
Yeah, one of the challenges, Laurie, is, you know, these players, you can say one thing to follow a scout, but, you know, that's her go-to. A pull-up jumper, one or two dribbles, and that one wasn't contested. You know, she's going to make that all night. I mean, the quality of the athletes that we're watching here is sublime.
Really misses those, Jackie Young. 21 points in game one. She's up to 10 already here. Still 4 to go before the half. Perth back ahead by 2.
Little extended pressure off the back of that free throw just to, you know, chew some clock off the Melbourne Boomers as they now get set with a ball screen with 8 seconds on the shot clock.
Reach around called on Marina Mabry. Tess Magin still looking for her first points tonight.
She's a real glue piece for this team. You know, even if she's not making shots defensively, she generally does a hell of a job. You know, she does little things. As we see here, you know, sacrifice cuts, gets on the boards,
You look at the rest of her stat line. She's got
seven assists.
Seven assists. And four rebounds already in the game, despite not having any in the points column. As Allen's turnaround jump was a little long.
And you probably don't need to get any points when Lindsay Allen's got 14.
It's Young who shoots the three, rattles out. First grand final series for Tess Manchin. She got to Townsville just after their golden run and now been with the Boomers for the last couple of seasons. And Steph Mitchell runs into some traffic under the hoop.
Yeah, that really surprised me when I heard that in her interview after their win over Adelaide, that this will be their first time in a grand final series. She's had such a great career and been with some very successful teams and success herself, that to hear she hadn't made a grand final really surprised me.
Mitchell makes her first at the line. She's had a knack this year to score big points in the second half of games. So we've done a number of her games this year, the nationally televised matches, where look at her stat line at halftime and she'll have two, and then by the end of the game, she's got her 17 or 18 as she has most nights during the season.
And I think that's, that may well be what we see tonight. You know, the Perth Lynx are going to have to make some adjustment. Who are they going to put on Lindsay Allen? Are they going to make some adjustment to her? That then opens obviously someone else up. If they shift a defensive matchup or something else happen, it tends to open up for one of the other star talents. Speaking of star talent, Jackie Young to the rim again, can't make that one go, and nor does she get the call on the base out of bounds.
She is so athletic, Jackie Young. Her ability to go from zero and then explosiveness and then to pull up on a dime, she's great to watch.
Jackie Young and Marina Mabry, two of the imports for Perth, and Lindsay Allen, who you've seen involved already tonight with 14 points for the Boomers, all played together for a season NCAA ball for Notre Dame. As Mitchell shakes Mabry and can't finish. Offensive rebound again, McGregor misses the putback.
Disappointed in those two shots, a wide open layup and then a putback for Ezzy. That was an opportunity missed.
Still locked at 37. Whitcomb drives, kicks it out. Garbin for three. Not quite.
Got to say, on the three-point attempt shot chart, that corner shot isn't Garbin's favourite spot. She much prefers that wing spot, the top of the D. Maybe that's where Melbourne Boomers have said, look, let's pack in off that one and almost allow the three. But, she's had two bites of it. Let's see if she can hit a third one.
Nice work from Scherf. Affects the shot. Young for two from the elbow. Doesn't go. All knotted up at 37 as we tick towards the half. We'll talk about both teams defensively, particularly in this quarter. It's tightened up. Ernst for three off the iron. Over the backboard. It'll be Perth ball. So you look at the points in this quarter alone. They're scoring 9-12 in the term. After we had 28-25 at quarter time.
Yeah, it was looking like a 100-point ball game off the back of that first quarter. Settled into a little bit more, a little bit of fatigue. The bench have come in for both teams, but look, this one's going to be seesawing through to the end.
It's the Boomers winning the quarter by three after Perth held that advantage at quarter time. Perth win here, and they're WNBL champions for the first time in three decades.
That was great defense by Tess Madgen. She just kept her in front, contained her, and she had nowhere to go. Really good defense.
Here's Allen, draws the foul to be called on the defender. The points won't count. Lindsay Allen's night already, 14 points, three rebounds, and an assist. Whitcomb shifting across court for the block.
Can she keep it up? Lindsay Allen. She's had a great start to this one.
She had 13 points in game one. She's up to 14 already with a pair of foul shots here.
Like I say, I've been impressed, Laurie, with Melbourne's ability to get deep into the lane, either with, dribble penetration, with follow-up from their bigs, some nice little rim rolls from their bigs off some ball screen action. I think their deep attack into the key has made a huge difference for them tonight.
Well, and then it enables them that if they do collapse the defense, to then kick it out to waiting shooters, and then you're also in a good rebounding position as well. So it's really made a difference.
2 of 2, Melbourne back ahead, and Mabry wiped away that advantage.
I'm not sure that's that was their ball screen defensive scout on Mabry to, you know, get stuck going under that pick for her. You're giving her a wide open look. They got it, you know. Although they look much better when they were switching on some of those if they were caught.
Pass broken up. Perth come up with it. Garvin and Whitcomb link up. Scherf down low. Goes to work on Magmagor. Allen tries to come and land a hand. Clean look for Young. It's a little long. There's a foul caught on the scrap underneath the bucket. And the foul will be called on the Boomers.
Again, good defensive set. You know, Ezzie McBeggar giving away, you know, size advantage and weight advantage. But she's played the right scout. She sat on the correct shoulder for Scherf, who likes to come back to that opposite shoulder. It kicks out to Young. And again, good defense in the one-on-one contest. Dare to shoot the three-point shot. That's not her thing.
Yeah.
Final play of the half. Mabry, whose range is unlimited, works inside the lane, puts up the runner, doesn't go. 3 seconds on the game clock, ticking towards the half. Allen for the last to underscore her impact on this half of basketball. Lindsay Allen fills it up again, and the Melbourne Boomers lead it by 3 at the half. Lindsay Allen has 19 of them.
Wow, that will just make them go into this halftime with that momentum, that, you know, feel like we can get this done. We can win this game too. And for Perth, well, they're just going to have to find some ways and means of stopping LA.
Let's catch up with her, Megan Haswaite, with Lindsay Allen courtside.
There are sparks flying off Lindsay Allen at the moment. You needed to come out and have a big first half. How important was it to play great D?
Yeah, that was a really key focus for us in this game. Just be more aggressive on D and just be more disruptive. I mean, they're a talented team. They're going to hit shots. They're going to get into their stuff. I mean, they're hitting a lot of shots right now, but just stay solid and really help each other.
You're solid and then some in the first half. How are you feeling out there?
Yeah, good. I mean, we'll just keep moving the ball, keep taking our shots, keep looking for each other, and just play confident.
Thanks for your time. Good luck in the second.
Thanks, Megan.
She's balling out, Lindsay Allen. 19 points in that half. She's 4 of 4 from three-point land. She averages 13.5 points a game this season and had 13 in game one, having some sort of impact. And this is the final play of the first half, just in the nick of time.
She got that off. Sorry, Graffy. She got that off as the buzzer went, you know, perfectly timed.
Let's catch up with the Perth Lynx. Sammy Whitcomb is with Megan Haswaite.
Sammy, you knew that they were going to come out and defend better and play something a bit different. Is it what you expected?
Yeah, absolutely. They're a tough side. I knew that they'd make it more difficult. They'd make some adjustments. They'd be more aggressive offensively, all those things. And they're all those things. And I think we've let ourselves down, I think, with our intensity, for sure.
What do you need to do other than lift the intensity?
Yeah, I think obviously we gave up too many O boards, so I think that's got to be a factor for us. Lindsay's made early shots. We have to find her now. And I think we have to do a better job, be more disciplined in moving the ball offensively.
Thanks for your time. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks, Sammy.
Thanks to Sammy Whitcomb and to Megan Haswaite. And there are the numbers through the first half. The Melbourne Boomers, after being down 3 at quarter time, they need to win this game to push a third and deciding game and extend the season. A 6-point swing in that second quarter. They lead it by 3 at the half.
Well, I'd have to say the standout for me compared to game one is 2 for 10 from the three-point line for the Lynx. They're not as red hot as they were, but the other thing for me is the Melbourne Boomers are playing a real team game. You could see by the number of assists that they had. They're moving the ball really well. But Jackie Young, as you mentioned, Graffy, is key to this team.
Here are the highlights of that first half of basketball, and Lindsay Allen responsible for a number of them with 19 points, 9 of them coming in that second term. And as a result, it's the Boomers who lead it by 3 at halftime. Game on the line, a second game of the best of 3 series, a closeout match for the Perth Lynx at home. While the Melbourne Boomers, desperation belongs with them, they must be winning here to extend the series and remain alive in the season.
Icon Services is a market leader offering 4 integrated property and service divisions in cleaning, hygiene and washroom, waste and recycling, and property services. Find out why Australia's largest spaces and most iconic places only trust the Icon brand. Icon, solutions that matter.
With doubt and dismay, you are smitten. You think there's no chance for you, none. Why the best books haven't been written, the best race hasn't been run, the best tune hasn't been played yet. Cheer up, for the world is young. But the best jobs haven't been started, the best work hasn't been done.
Halftime in Game 2 of the WNBL Grand Final Series, and Lindsay Allen has 19 points and a half of basketball. And the Melbourne Boomers, it's really survived in advance from here. They were 3 points down at quarter time, having dropped Game 1 of the series at home by a wide margin. They had to respond, and they did in that second quarter, outscoring the Perth Lynx by 6. And as a result, at halftime, they hold a 3-point buffer courtesy of this bucket right on the halftime buzzer for Lindsay Allen. The Melbourne Boomers lead it by 3 at halftime. Cary Graff, you spoke a bit about the adjustments that needed to be made. What have you seen here in Game 2, particularly from the Boomers?
Yeah, look, I think first and foremost, their defensive intensity has gone through the roof. Defense wins championships. You know, it's an old adage, but I'm going to say it's true. You know, I think offensively, they've attacked the rim much harder. They've had much better player movement, and they've had engagement for more athletes. And critically, as we've seen, Lindsay Allen has just stepped up and said, you know, we're not going home without a W here.
Mm. It's a real chance for Perth basketball. They've had a number of different owners since their last championship. They've had a number of different names. They were the Breakers, became the Lynx, then the West Coast Waves, then back to the Lynx again. So a historic night perhaps for Perth basketball, the opportunity to try and cut down the nets at home and deliver the city just their second WNBL title. It would be the first in 30 years. Megan Huswaite is courtside with us. Megan, I understand you've got a very special guest alongside you as well, and one woman who'll know all about that championship team from 30 years ago.
She sure does. Tanya Fisher was the grand final MVP in Perth's only championship in 1992. She's here tonight. Tanya, you won that championship about 500 metres away from this venue.
We did indeed, in the old Mount Claremont Superdrome. Yeah, good memories.
How much would you like to have another Perth team to share a championship with?
You have no idea. I think I'm more nervous than anyone playing on the court at the moment. So much harder as a spectator than what it was that I remember as a player, that's for sure.
Let's talk about that grand final in 1992. You beat Dandenong by 4 points. You were the MVP of that grand final, coached by Tom Maher, Robin Maher and Michelle Timms were your teammates, and some great WA talent. Great memories.
Oh, fantastic memories. Like, yeah, it was a hell of a year. It was intense. It was a ton of hard work. And in the end, it felt like we tripped across the finish line rather than romped across it, because it was difficult. But it was easy. Everyone would do it, wouldn't they? So
these days, championship players get a championship ring, medals, trophies. What did you get for your efforts back in 1992?
I got a silver peanut tray.
Have you ever put peanuts in the tray?
No, it's never come off my shelf.
Well, if Perth are to triumph tonight, Tanya, you will be part of the official ceremony a bit later. So we hope for your and the Lynx sake to see you a bit later. But thank you for joining us. It's great to see you 30 years on. And for your sake, hopefully the Red Army can come through tonight.
Absolutely. Thanks, Megan. Thank you. Thanks.
And hopefully And hopefully that pin-up tray comes out at some stage tonight in celebration for Tanya Fisher and for Perth basketball, trying to do something that hasn't been done for 30 years and deliver a WNBL championship to the city of Perth. Their team is down by 3 at halftime. It's the Melbourne Boomers who lead it. Just a single possession game. Second half action around the corner.
We're thinking of grabbing a bite tonight. Any new places close by?
Well, actually... Oh, and there's also...
Oh.
I think 20 is enough.
Yeah, that should do us.
Exactly what you want in a grand final game. It's a closeout game for the Perth Lynx. And the Melbourne Boomers, they must win to extend not just the series, but also the WNBL season. The Lynx can be crowned champions if they can overturn a three-point halftime deficit here at the Bendat Basketball Centre. 42-39, a highly entertaining half of basketball so far. Laurie Chiswick, biggest takeaway so far. What are you looking for early stages here in the third?
Well, I think the Boomers have to continue in the same light they started the game, the same intensity, the same focus, if not bring it up a notch, because as we said at the opener, their season is on the line. So defensively, they need to still put that pressure, be up and in, and offensively, keep that ball and player movement and keep attacking the rim like they've been doing.
Yeah, and I think the Perth Lynx, you know, they're going to come out of that timeout. Coach Petrick knew they're going to have, you know, be ready for some adjustments, anticipating what some of those might be. They will have had a chance to go back into the locker room, talk about some of those adjustments that they need to make both offensively and defensively with the counterattacks that they've seen Melbourne bring to this game.
That was Guy Malloy on screen. That was the voice of Cary Graff. Guy Malloy potentially coaching his final game in the WNBL. It's a career which spans across five different decades. He's coached both these teams. Actually overtook both sides after championships under the same man in Tom Maher, who led both teams to their only title. Second half action underway. Is it the last half of the season? George for three. Not quite. Rims out. Another O-board of the putback for Kayla George.
That basket started with great ball movement coming back to Kayla George, and then her shooting it and blasting in, as we tell everybody to do, and get her own rebound.
As he scoops it up in the backcourt. So another stop for Melbourne. Perth led the game by as many as six in the opening quarter. Mitchell, turnaround, Jay's good. We've got a new game high. It's the Boomers by seven.
Wow. They've come out with a lot of energy, Melbourne Boomers, and Perth just need to settle. They just need to do what they've been doing in the past. You know, they've got good shooters. They've got, you know, a good structure in place.
Whitcomb swings it to the corner. Young up top to Mabry for three.
Rims out. George the rebound.
Mowbray's, you know, you can see now, is it fatigue setting in? Is it a little frustration? Front of the rim on that three ball. You know, as you say, Laurie, Melbourne Boomers' defensive intensity has been on point again. And offensively, their ball movement, as we see them move the ball again through Magin and George in the two game. Short on the rim for George, but great possession play by Mitchell.
Clever from Scherf after the early miss on the rebound. Just taps it to Whitcomb's advantage. Sees the hole in the lane, takes it to the rack and draws the foul. Just keeping up with Kayla George. I'll make that three personals on Kayla now.
Smart highest play.
Highest of any player on the court, along with Tess Magin with three.
Yeah, that's what the smart, you know, the players with IQ. Sammy Whitcomb is acutely aware of what's going on with this game. She would know absolutely that Kayla George is on too. You saw her go straight at her body. She's either going to create space to get a shot away from the shot blocker, or she draws a foul, which she did, and puts herself at the free throw line, and she's an 80% plus free throw shooter.
And her teammates know that. They didn't even bother to stand in the lane. She knocks those two down. 5-point spread. It was a wide margin in game one, 27 points in the finish, and it was 28 the difference at halftime. As George turnaround Jane misses in the short corner.
Yeah, didn't see much of that in game one, but we're seeing it. You know, Kayla George getting down on the low block as we see Mabry sucker a foul, convert for two. The great players find a way.
And that's the thing, if Perth aren't shooting particularly well from the three-point line right now, they're finding ways and means to get themselves to the basket, get themselves to the foul line. So smart play by Perth.
Yeah, she doesn't hit the three-point shot, but she gets a three-point play.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like that, after a seven-point deficit, it's back to a one-possession game.
Again, the extended pressure off the free throws, a little 1-2-2 press from Perth, but Izzy McBeggar almost says, yeah, you know, I can break that press, but...
Misses at the rim. Now Mabry knocks it down to return Perth to the front.
This is where it's dangerous. You know, this is where Mabry can be that X factor. You know, she can incite the crowd. She hits a big shot. She gets the crowd involved. And that's what home court advantage is about. It's not about the rims you play on or practice on. It's how do you get the crowd on your back? And it's shots and then emotion like that from Mabry that can do just that.
Megan Haswaite courtside.
That's why... Carrie Graff is the championship coach. She is. That is exactly what Marina Mabry has been doing. She's been revving the crowd up, and they are coming along with her as she hits that massive shot. They are really firing up here now, the Red Army.
The thing with Melbourne is they cannot. So that was a... She was just standing at that three-point line waiting. You've got to match up on her early and force her to put it to the ground and you know, get off that three-point line.
George
unafraid.
From three-point land, bangs it down.
That's how you silence a crowd.
That's exactly right.
Second lead change of the quarter. We're up to 11 in the ball game. 11 lead changes. Up to Perth, pretty much led start to finish on Saturday. Whitcomb misses the layup.
This is what the great championship games are all about. You know, it's an arm wrestle, slight momentum swings one way, another way. Huge shot from a star player, responds with a big three from the opposition. It's all happening right here.
Mitchell finds her way to the rack, can't finish. Let's run, says Mabry. Oh, takes out the defender. Whitcomb allowed to shoot it, doesn't go, and George the rebound.
Referee's happy to let that one just roll along.
Gee, the stars are out. Mabry up to 17. George has 15 to go along with seven boards. 19 for this woman. Lindsay Allen kicks it out to George. There's a foul called down low, and Whitcomb called with a reach in. Here's a look from Sammy Whitcomb. And the no call. Mabry on Allen. It feels like it's just getting good. This is what we wanted in the series. 11.
Sammy Whitcomb's third personal foul.
In the corner for three. Mitchell misfires. Allen keeps it alive in the front court. 11 lead changes.
Mismatch here. Ernst Whitcomb on her. Drop her down to the rim.
Shot up. Doesn't go.
Oh.
Allen. Mitchell scraps after the O-board. Lindsay Allen settles up top. Not quite. And Scherf, a strong rebound. Here's Mabry. One-on-one with Allen. Loose handle. Regathers in the corner.
Tough D. LA.
Whitcomb tacks the hoop. Fouled. Be called on Tiffany Mitchell, her second, and Sammy Whitcomb to the charity stripe.
Great footwork from Lindsay Allen.
Megan Haswaite, courtside.
Benches down here very aware of the fouls that you guys were just mentioning, particularly for those key players. So going to be interesting in this final 5 minutes to see whether some bench rotations come in to preserve those players.
Three on Kayla George, three on Tess Madge, and three on Sammy Whitcomb. Those in some kind of danger.
Yeah, look, and it's an opportunity for teams to go at them. Can you sucker a fourth foul off one of those, you know, one of those starters from, you know, and key players for each of the teams?
What do you make of the Perth team not lining the keyway for the Whitcomb foul shots?
Yeah, look, it's reminiscent to me of Eddie Palabinska's, one of Australia's greatest shooters ever, and he'd even tell his teammates, don't line up, these go down. If you shoot nearly 90% from the free throw line, why not?
He made the second one there, 1-point game. And tough lay-in from Lindsay Allen. Starts her scoring after halftime. She's up to 21.
The other thing about that is they always, after foul shot, go into that extended pressure. And so that just gives them the opportunity to set it up easily as well.
Laurie Chiswick and Carrie Graff. Grand final game two. Five to go into third. Perth throw it away. Still at three as it was at the half. But an interesting way of getting there. Two lead changes in the quarter already. 11 for the game. And a hand in from Mabry, but caught some of the arm on the way through. Will pick up the foul. In fact, it was on... Was it on Jackie Young? No, it was Mabry. And the second reach in.
That's only her first foul, so she's safe right now.
Tiff Mitchell, the 27-year-old, 86% from the free throw line.
Well, that's one thing about the Melbourne Boomers. You know, four of their starters who are on the court now have an 80-plus free throw. So Perth are really aware of that, don't want to send them to the line.
And that's elite free throw shooting, Laurie, and that's what these star athletes should be. You know, they're professional athletes. The best shooters, the best players should be shooting 80-plus.
Yeah.
There's the numbers on the free shots tonight. So 10 of 11 for Melbourne, 9 of 11 for the home team. Young, turnaround Jay, not quite, and Ernst on the rebound.
So you can see Perth are playing five out. Everybody's out, so they're leaving the driving lanes open, and Melbourne right now are doing a good job of containment.
Two-possession game, Carly Ernst up top. Out to Mitchell, pulls up. A little long, and Mabry on the rebound. Oh, the quarterback pass cut out by Izzy Wright. Trying to heave it down the floor. Ernst, we know her range from here. She lays it all the way in, though. A trip to the hoop, and all of a sudden, Melbourne back up by seven. An equal game high, and Ryan Petrick says, I want to have a chat. Timeout, Perth.
To be honest, there haven't been a lot of timeouts in this game. The coaches have just let the players go at it and you know, trying to make adjustments. But obviously he's seen enough and knows that this margin can't afford to blow out any more than it is right now.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the things that Coach Petrick does exceptionally well. He uses momentum timeouts, and that's what he's done here. There hasn't been a need prior.
Twice they've led it by 7 points at various stages of this quarter. And that's the margin at the moment. The Boomers up. Here's Coach Petrick.
Pin, get out of it. Again, pick and roll. Again, that flare screen is happening the same time as the on ball is happening. Jack getting to a right. We good? Again, we're in blue in the pick and roll coverage until it gets too deep. Once it gets too deep, then it's a switch or a hustle. Again, big two forms of communication, verbal and physical. Again, it's reroute the guard. With the Allen, as much as I can with Allen, I want to try and get Sharpie onto it. Actually, no, because you're playing the four, aren't you? Apologies. Get Jack then to Allen. We good? Wait.
So we hear Ryan Petrick there, you know, organising what he wants offensively, some ball screen action with a flare flare screen to activate that weak side help. And just talking about the matchups that he wants on Allen, you know, she's critical for them right now. To, you know, can they lock her up? Can they make it tough for them? And just talking about, you know, if we're in trouble, let's get to a situation. We're going to stick with our drops on the ball screen action, but that we need to look to switch or double team it down low.
7-point game. Young pulls up. Scrapping after it, Sharp grabs possession, rides the bump, gets the call.
I don't think Guy Malloy would be too dissatisfied with that foul from Carly Ernst. That was just a hustle foul. She was going after it, and, you know, at least it's now they can stop and get their defense set.
3:40 to go in the third. Mabry on the perimeter. Back to Young, who has 10 for the night. Off the dribble. Mid-range J doesn't go, and Kayla George pulls down another board. She's up to 8 for the game.
LA just controlling tempo here for the Melbourne Boomers.
3 to go before three-quarter time.
A little pick-to-picker action. Back to a mid-pick and roll.
They need to keep moving, Melbourne Boomers.
Allen pulls up, handed her face, hits it anyway.
Or just clear out and let LA play one-on-one. Wow. Is she a star? And a star tonight.
New game high. It's up to 9, the margin. And Lindsay Allen has 23. Still with a quarter and a bit to play. Cipitone up top for Garvin. Goes back to the three and knocks it down.
That is her favorite spot. X marks the spot there for Darcy Garvin. I could just think of the numbers that she scored the other night from that exact spot.
Back to a two-possession game. Right to George. Back up top to Izzy Wright.
Sensing some tired bodies from both teams at the moment. Standing around a bit, little less offensive movement.
Ernst doesn't get the shooter's roll. Perth come up with the ball. A two-possession game. Garvin, can she do it again? Off to Mabry. Mabry pulls up off the dribble. No good. Sharp the O-board. Garvin up top. Got it.
Oh, that's the one. That was all. I'd be pointing my finger at Sharpie and going, thank you very much for that effort, that O-board, and getting it out to me.
Back-to-back threes for Darcy Garvin, and all of a sudden, back to a three-point game. Mitchell, step back. No. Sharp the rebound. Let's run, says Jackie Young. Kicks it to the corner. Cipitone to tie the game. The high arcing three misses.
And there is Alex Sharp again in after the O-boards. She has just brought that energy from the bench for the Perth Lynx.
Young takes it inside, too much on the jump shot.
And another
jump
one.
Again, passing through.
If there's one thing on her scout report, it'd be block. I won't swear. Block the hell out.
Megan Haswaite courtside.
The roof's about to blow off here at Bendat Basketball Stadium, and Sammy Whitcomb is leading the charge. The crowd are chanting Sharpie after those incredible moments by Alex Sharp. They do call the third quarter the championship quarter after all.
8 rebounds, 5 of them on the offensive end for Alex Sharp in the minute she's played tonight. And now some foul shots.
I'm going to say that was Maley-esque, those last 3 offensive possessions.
Yes, yeah.
That's a hell of a compliment for league MVP Annalee Maley. She's about 1 of 2 from the foul line all season. Sharp knocks down both of them. Momentum with the red team, and Perth are coming twice from 7 down to get it within a point on the stroke of three-quarter time.
Interesting here, Laurie. You know, if you're Guy Malloy, do you call a momentum timeout right now? You know, the margin's whittled away. The momentum's definitely with Perth. Do you hold it? Do you call one?
Mitchell trying to do it herself. Down to Davidson, swings it out. George, clean look, misses. Mitchell, O-board. Whitcomb tries to steal it from her. No call from the refs. 8 on the shot clock. Allen, leading all scorers, gets a look at it. Free player in the corner, right for 3. Can't get it to go. And guess who underneath the bucket? It's Alex Sharp with her 9th board. What a role she's playing. And Perth can take the lead here. A couple of possessions before three-quarter time. Scherf out to Garvin for a third three of the quarter. Misses everything. Last touch by Allen. And Caleb George just pointing out, what about the shot clock? And they'll get possession.
Well, that was a great block out by Lindsay Allen. You know, she had a much bigger player to block out and just needed that grit and determination to get it done.
What do the Melbourne Boomers go with here, Laurie? They play this last shot. Is it a two-man game with Lindsay Allen and Kayla George?
Well, all I know is they've got to make sure they use the whole clock and don't give Perth any opportunity to go down to the other end and score.
Made an excellent game of basketball. 11 lead changes already. Allen, bounce pass to Davidson, off glass for two.
That'll do.
Well executed, you know, 2 seconds left for Perth to attempt something and it didn't eventuate.
So that'll do us through three, and as it was at halftime, it's the Melbourne Boomers who lead it by three. A single possession game with a quarter to come. Will it be the last quarter of the season?
Is there a right moment for your next career step? Can you have a stellar career filled with passion? Yes, but it all starts with you. Get experience connected and ready with mid-year entry at the University of Canberra.
Game two of the grand final series, the best of three. The Perth Lynx are they 10 minutes away from claiming Perth's first WNBL crown in 30 years? Or can the Melbourne Boomers protect a three-point buffer at three-quarter time and push it to a series decider on Saturday back in Melbourne? Also looking for just their second title in franchise history. They were beaten comprehensively by 27 in game one. They've led for large periods of the second half. In game two, Megan Huswaite courtside.
Sharp and Cipitone are starting for Perth in this quarter with the imports on the bench. Perth know what's ahead of them. Ryan Petrick wants to see some great D from them in the opening minutes of this final term.
11 lead changes for the Knights, six of them in the opening quarter, two in that third term. George pulls up for two, left short. And the only two in any kind of foul trouble. Whitcomb has three for George and Magin. Nine and a bit to go.
I don't know about you guys, but my heart rate is right up there. Can you imagine the coaches and the players? It's fantastic. This is what we want in a grand final series.
Whitcomb, the runner for two, brings it back to a one-point game.
And it's been an arm wrestle. Momentum swings through big plays, making big shots, three-point shots at the end of quarters, possession plays. This is what the big games are all about.
Oh, it's double dribble on Kayla George. She knew it as soon as she had a slight fumble.
That's when you sort of look at the referee and go, oh, I hope you didn't see that.
That's an unforced error. And hands possession back to Perth, who led the game by six in the opening quarter and have fallen behind by seven on two different occasions. Whitcomb up top, shanks the defender in right, puts it up, no good. Long rebound for Whitcomb. Have another go.
Interesting, both coaches have started this fourth quarter with some of their bench players on, thinking perhaps down the stretch they want to bring home with their starters. As Sammy Whitcomb goes to work, puts her own shot back in.
She will not be denied. Sammy Whitcomb, her third look at that set. And eventually gets the points to return Perth to the lead. 12th lead change in the game. George, not afraid from up top. Shoots the three again. It doesn't go. Last touch, Davidson over the baseline. Perth ball.
Again, veteran, smart player. Knows she's got the younger athlete on her. He's going to go at her. You know, Boomers here, some good possession play by Davidson, but couldn't quite come up with it. But boy, Sammy Whitcomb knows who to attack and when.
Guy Malloy and the captain, Kayla George. Could this be his final quarter of basketball? A coaching career which started in the 80s. He's extended through now into a fifth decade, but coaching what may be his final game in charge of the Boomers, and Mabry's trying to make sure of it. Hits the mid-range two, it's out to three, the length sway.
She was so composed doing that. There was just never any doubt she was going to shoot it.
Almost slow motion, and Perth have scored the last 12. Momentum certainly back in their court.
And Mabry doing it on both sides of the ball. Alert defensively and in the passing lane.
And it's just a little tentative on both those plays. A little tentative defensively, a little tentative on that, you know, attempt at dribble handoff.
14-2 the run. If you want to go back further than that, Allen almost has a pocket pick by Whitcomb. Whitcomb scrapping for it. And Lindsay Allen.
That'll be Sammy Whitcomb's fourth foul. That's pretty crucial at this stage with lots of time left in this game.
What a role she's played so far, Whitcomb. 14 points on the offensive end, but four boards. And now she's going to have to sit 7.5 to go in the final term.
You'd have to say, though, if there's any player on the court or on these two teams that could play with four fouls, it would be Sammy Whitcomb and her experience.
Absolutely agree, Laurie.
Is that a turning point in the game? Points have dried up for Melbourne. George up top to Allen. Settles on it. Pulls up for the deep two. And it drops.
She is tough tonight. You know, Kayla George went a little hesitant on that three. She missed the last one, but who do I go to? Money lady today, Lindsay Allen.
25 points for Allen, 19 of them in the first half. From long range, Mabry doesn't go, and Mitchell on the board.
That's one thing that's key for Melbourne in this last 6 minutes is that they've got to make sure every contested shot that Perth take, they are one and done. They don't give them any second chance opportunities.
Mitchell goes baseline. George, look up top. Not quite. Left it short.
All her short shots are just falling short, Kayla.
She's 3 of 10 from three-point land, Kayla George. Perth by one. Oh, Garvin DeYoung, and Young loses the handle over the sideline.
And this is when the pressure sets in too, doesn't it? You know, fatigue, it's been an arm wrestle all game. Just that little, you know, slight little focus slip and you get a turnover.
Six to play.
Well, that's like Kayla George's double dribble. Same thing, you know, very uncharacteristic of Jackie Young or a Kayla George.
Best of three series, Perth one up. Are they 6 minutes away from a title? Or the Melbourne Boomers needing to win to get us to a deciding game on Saturday back in Melbourne. Magnagore rattles it home. Puts Melbourne back in front. 13th lead change in the game.
Can they see, can Ezzy get a bit more of that? Can she get at the rim? You know, the Melbourne Boomers can't leave it all to LA. They need some other people stepping up.
Young can't finish the rim.
Again, LA with, you know, great momentum control here. See if they can get some movement, Melbourne Boomers, some tired bodies, a bit of stagnant offense, standing around, allowing the Perth pack man-to-man defense to get set.
Allen around the screen, swings it up top. Tiff Mitchell for three. It's long, and Sharp comes up with her 10th board. Here's Mabry. Range unlimited, but driving to the rack. George, a deft touch on it. And then comes up with it for the Boomers.
Well, both teams look like they're running in mud right now. There's no easy baskets, no transition type baskets.
They do. And LA looked over at Coach Guy Malloy to get a call. She feeds it inside to Ezzie McBeggar down low for two.
Just that little hesitation. Am I going to make her defense think that she was going to shoot it? And then just a great executed pass.
Makes it a three-point game back the other way. Mabry thought about the look. Links up with Garbin for the corner three. Again, doesn't go from the corner for Darcy Garbin. And George holds out on the rebound.
Good D on that ball screen then by the Melbourne Boomers. No way were they going to let Mabry get it off. As we see LA pull up for the J at the free throw line and money again.
Those were the ones that weren't dropping the other day, and they are dropping now. So I'll be interested to see if Perth make any adjustment, because Scherf is standing back and LA's hot now. She wasn't the other game, so it worked. But right now, I just keep going to that.
They've twice wiped off a seven-point deficit, Perth. They're down by five.
Wow.
Young comes up with the basket they needed.
I can do what you can do, says Jackie Young.
Just a nice little answer.
Back to a single possession game with 3:40 to go in game two. Allen, who's been sensational with 27. Magligore up top to George. Around to Mitchell. Passes through the lane, back to Ezzy. Rides the contact from Sherp for the baseline. Jay from Kayla George. Five-point game again.
Kayla George likes that little short corner. She's, you know, sweet at that. As Mabry gets in deep to the lane, kicks it out to Young.
Mabry from the corner gets the foul. It's George's fourth. And three at the charity stripe to come for the Lynx. And who better to take them? Mabry with 19 already. What a game of basketball. 13 lead changes. The Boomers have twice led it by seven. Perth led it by six in the opening quarter. And that's as wide as it's been either way.
You know, I said in the opener that tonight's game, I was hoping we were going to see a display of elite women's basketball. And it has gone above and beyond expectations. There has just been some great team play, great individual plays, both ends of the court, Graffy.
Yeah, absolutely. Possession play, all the things that you expect from these big games. It's got it all. Interestingly, Coach Guy Malloy's, you know, choosing to leave Kayla George out there right now. Maybe he makes a sub after this offensive set. She's sitting on four. Sammy Whitcomb sitting on the bench for Perth with her four.
All three of those go in. Back to a two-point game. Allen from the free throw line, two more. She's up to 29.
Laurie, you called it earlier. You know, do they need to change that ball screen? Do they stick with their, you know, their go-to system on that is drops where they pack the big defender down low in the keyway. But LA is just doing a shooting drill right now. Just take two drills, shoot a pull-up, Jay. They've got to change that defense.
Whitcomb to the corner for Garbin. Back to Whitcomb. Tries to go at George. Cipitone shoots with time running down. A rainbow three misses.
That was smart by Perth, because Sammy's going, Kayla, you got to guard me. You got four fouls. What are you going to do?
Opal v. Opal. LA again on the pull-up. Not to go this time.
Whitcomb on the rebound. Let's run, she says. Straight at George. Bounce pass out to Young. They'll settle things down with 16 on the red numbers. Two to go in the game. Melbourne by four. Mabry, step back three. That's cash from Marina Mabry.
That did not touch the rim. That was nothing but net. Oh my goodness.
I think the roof has blown off this stadium. That is the sort of shot that a crowd will erupt for. What a shot. I mean, and this is her favorite thing. At the D, step back, pull it back between your legs, drain the three, not bobble in, swish it. I mean, that's talent. Look at that.
What a way to get the crowd going. The Red Army at the Bendat Basketball Center playing from behind the majority of the second half. And now with less than two on the clock, they're within one, the Perth Lynx, trying to close out and win their first championship in three decades. Final 2 minutes, so we can't listen into the timeouts, but lucky we have Laurie Chiswick and Carrie Graff here, two championship-winning coaches, to tell us a little bit about what these coaches will be saying.
Oh, I forgot about that. I was ready to listen to them myself. But, well, so Guy Malloy right now, they've got offensive possession, so he's going to be drawing up a play of what he wants to do and how he wants to probably approach these last, 2 minutes. But it'll be all about getting a great play phase and a great shot this time.
Yeah, and Laurie, I think it's about, sticking to what's worked for them. Follow the scout. What's been working for us? Stick to that. Who do we not want the ball in hands? And I'd suggest that's Mabry. And what's working for us offensively, and stick to that.
Megan Haswaite, courtside. Megan.
Very calm in the Perth huddle there at the time out. Darcy Garvin, the skipper, was the first to address the group, and she put it very simply. Kayla has four. They're very aware of that right now. They're also going to look to go to Jackie Young in the final moments.
Four on Whitcomb, four on George. The two in foul trouble. Less than 2 minutes on the game clock. Boomers by one, needing to win to extend the season. Through to a deciding game on Saturday back at home. Allen takes it all the way to the hoop. It rims out.
Unlucky LA.
Final 100 seconds, 1 point game in a match that's seen 13 lead changes that may decide the championship. Young on the perimeter, goes to work on Magmagor, shot up, it's short. Garvin recovers it, heaves it back to Whitcomb. New 14, Mabry draws the foul on Lindsay Allen.
Smart foul by LA.
Yeah.
Gets her on the dribble, doesn't let her get in too deep to try and suck her a foul or force someone like Kayla George to come and help. As we see LA's miss.
Oh, and Guy's reaction to that miss.
She hasn't missed too many. Lindsay Allen, 29 points. She's 10 of 17.
And we see Sammy Whitcomb back on the court for these last minute and 14 seconds.
Mabry. Magmagor, no thanks, she says, swats it over the baseline. What a play from Ezzie.
Her timing on those blocks is so good. She doesn't let the smaller athletes have a sense of where her length is.
Now, there's
comes up late.
6 seconds on the clock. It's going to almost be a catch and shoot.
Young puts it up. Tough make, doesn't go. George pulls down the rebound. And in her landing spot is the zero, and Jackie Young called for the personal, her third.
Huge defensive board by Kayla George. Maintains possession.
63 seconds to go. Melbourne by a point.
I can imagine all the Melbourne Boomer fans are on the edge of their seats watching this last minute, even though it's late at night.
10:30 on the east coast of Australia. But out west, the Red Army is willing on the other result. The Boomers needing to win to extend the season. Allen on the perimeter. Eight left on the red numbers. Out to George. George for three! What a make from Kayla George!
To me, that was all that was planned. You could see LA playing with that on-ball screen, but not really looking like she was wanting to use it. And just suckering in the defense and left to Kayla George. We can see here, just sort of playing. Ezzie looks like she's coming. Kayla wide open and nails it.
She has missed 7 from long range tonight, Kayla George. A lot of those coming in the second half. But when it was time to shoot, she's not afraid. And the captain for the Boomers bangs it down in the clutch. A two-possession game with 42 seconds on the game clock.
Big-time players come up with big-time plays at big moments, and Kayla George just did that. As we know, long time to go in this game. 43 seconds. It's a two-possession ball game. Anything can happen right here. As we predicted, arm wrestle. This thing could go either way.
Megan Haswaite, courtside.
Guy Malloy, cool, calm and collected as he's ever been. He's got a timeout. He's told his players he's got that up his sleeve. But he believes Perth are going to try and get a two here off the rim.
Well, I would think that that's a good option for Perth. And they need a score this time. And what Melbourne have to be aware of, that if they don't score, then they're going to have to foul them. So they're going to have to be really strong on any sort of shot, rebound. But Perth really want to, explore whether there's a two or three open and take it.
Yeah, any shot's a good shot.
Yep.
All the stars on the floor with the game on the line. Young on the inbounds. Scherf and George caught in the tangle. Foul called on Scherf. Melbourne ball with 42 seconds to go. And they don't even get a look at it, Perth, from the inbounds.
Huge call. Let's see that replay. Great denial defense by Kayla George.
It wasn't. I was almost counting myself, thinking, it's getting close here. It's getting close. Kayla's hand was just in the passing lane. I'm not sure. Graffy, what do you think?
Good sucker play by Kayla George. Threw her head back.
Talk about big-time plays. One on the offensive end, and then Kayla George draws the foul.
Big play by Sammy Whitcomb, her active hands.
Whitcomb in transition, lays it up, can't finish. George the rebound. And it'll be tough now for Perth chasing the game.
They have to foul.
And chasing Allen down the floor. And with four at the margin, they do anything they can to stop the clock. Here's the attempted finish from Whitcomb. And George says, I'm having that.
Guy Malloy smiling with 15 seconds to go.
And Coach Petrick says, let's chat. Timeout called. And Guy Malloy, who was staring down the prospect of this being his final game in the WNBL before heading across the ditch for a coaching gig in New Zealand, desperately hoping to get to a deciding game. And I'm sure he would have taken this if you'd offered it to him, leading in up four with 15 seconds on the clock.
Coach Petrick here will be saying, you know, who is it that they want to foul? You know, and clearly, if Ezzie McBeggar's on the floor, allow her to make the catch, foul her. She's a subpar free throw shooter at the moment, certainly off the back of this season. She's around, you know, less than 50%. That's got to be their tactic defensively. Not always easy to pull off. And then, again, you know, it's right now it's a two-possession game, but they've got to get up and shoot the ball quickly if they can, force, you know, free throws for the Boomers and then get up a quick three.
Well, Melbourne have to play that smothering defense they did at the last time that there was a side ball and Kayla was in the passing lanes and I almost thought they got a five-second violation.
Mabry has 25, Allen has 29, George 20 to go along with 12 rebounds. So the Stars have pulled up big numbers. And we're back here again with the inbounds for Perth. Here's Young. Young swings into the corner, Mabry for three. Oh. Yes! It's a one-point game with 9 on the clock. This game keeps delivering again and again. Another twist. The Lynx within one.
Wow. And I've got to say, something happened prior to that possession for it to be Perth's ball. Yeah. I was sure it was Melbourne's ball. As we see Young penetrate deep, out to the wide open Mabry, sinks the three. Huge three-point shot.
So now Guy Malloy, in this timeout, will want to advance the ball so that he's, you know, they've got it down in their offensive end. And for them, it's a matter of, they don't have to take a shot. They have to take care of the ball. They have to get the ball in, and they have to take care of it.
And get the ball to their best free throw shooters. You know, they need their best feeder inbounding the ball. Who's their great passer that can make the decision to get the ball to the right people? And then they need their best free throw shooters coming to the ball. Is it Lindsay Allen coming to the ball? Is it, you know, is Ezzie diving to the rim to clear out of there?
Probably almost get Tess Madgen throwing it in as a really smart decision maker, high IQ. And then you've got the height of Ezzie and George to get it into, or Lindsay Allen and your athletic Mitchell to duck and weave and get the pass.
Big time hits on both sides of the floor. And now Melbourne by one with 9 seconds left. Megan Huswaite.
Ryan Petrick doesn't have a timeout left, so they're after fouls, and then he's going to sub Sammy Whitcomb back into the game. Let's see what happens next.
9 seconds on the clock. Melbourne on the inbounds. Madgen gets it in to Allen. Mabry fouls. Foul shots for Lindsay Allen. Clock stops at 7.
Do they get bigger than these two free throws?
Oh, in fact, they got one to give.
Oh, right, yes.
Ball's got to get back in the hands of Lindsay Allen, as you called it, Laurie. Tess Madgen is the feeder inbound, or Kayla George straight to the ball.
Catches, is fouled. And Mabry thought she got enough ball on that as it took a deflection off George over the sideline.
Clearly all over her wrist.
You got to plead your case, though, Graffy.
You do. I love that she does that.
So it'll be Kayla George to the foul line, who has had some big moments already in this final term. 87% on the season from the free throw line, Kayla George.
And as Megan said, there's no timeouts left, so they've got to know that if she makes two, they've got to come up and shoot a three. If she only makes the two of them, well then, the one, then it's a two-point ball game.
First time at the charity stripe tonight for Kayla George. Whoa. Ice is the first one.
As you said, Graffy, great players make great plays. And the fundamentals here at the foul line to make it a three-point game. It rattles in. 6 seconds on the clock. Perth, no timeouts. Three-point game. They get it in the hands of Mabry to tie the game on the buzzer. Hand on it on the way through. Is there a foul called? There is. Oh, my goodness. What a twist. A foul on the three-point shooter, and Mabry's going to the free throw line to tie the game.
There's no time left on the clock. It's over.
Foul called.
That is extraordinary.
Melbourne Boomers pleading their case that the time had expired.
Holy smokes. And the refs have a conference. And it looks like we could have three foul shots coming up. Megan Huswait.
Can they go to the videotape?
Deja vu. Deja vu here. The last time a series went to game three, there was controversy in Adelaide as the Lightning threw Nicole Seacamp one in the dying seconds to take it to a deciding game. What's going to happen here? It's over to Marina Mabry.
Wow, it looks like they're 0.2 of a second on the clock. Well, now you talked about those foul shots for Kayla George. Oh. What about these for Mabry?
How about the look on the faces of the Melbourne players as that call was made? Mabry at the line. Any miss will end the game. She hits the first.
Swish. Back iron. She's 4 of 4. Now 5 of 5 tonight from the free throw line. Exceptional free throw shooter.
Any miss will end the game. She makes the second.
I don't even think a commentator's curse is going to do anything for her tonight.
She hits this. We're going to OT. She misses and Melbourne win. Shot up. It's short.
Oh!
Boomers win. We're going to three. We're going to game three. 76-75. Melbourne think it's time to celebrate. And it is. With a deciding game to come Saturday back in Melbourne. And the brawl for it all in a final match with a bit of extra spice on Saturday. And the collision between Magin and Mabry after the missed foul shot. And Mabry puts up 30, but leaves the last foul shot short, which hands the W to the Melbourne Boomers. What a night.
I'm speechless. This game had every twist and turn that we could expect. And you know, Marina Mabry, you would just... I thought those three would be in. I thought, Graffy, you predicted overtime. Here we go.
Yeah, what a game. I mean, it had everything, didn't it? Big shots from big players at big moments of the game. It went down to the wire. It was an arm wrestle. There was massive possession plays. There was wonderful individual contests tonight in terms of sublime individual performances from both Lindsay Allen and from Mabry. Teamwork from both teams.
76-75. Boomers push a third and deciding game on Saturday. Megan Huswait.
With Kayla George, the captain of the Melbourne Boomers. Kayla, you go to game three.
Yeah, well, that's what we came here for, and that's what we're going home with. So I'm really excited. Job's not done at all. And, yeah, game three, new bloody rip snorter.
Tell me all the emotions right now. That was everything.
Oh, I mean, I'm shaking a little bit. What an ending. I don't really know what to say. First time in my life. I'm excited. I'm really excited. I'm proud of the girls. It's always tough to travel here and win here. And they've had a tremendous season, and they're tough to play here. So, I'm just really excited that it's going to game three. I wanted to change that narrative from game one for the last 5 days, however many freaking days it was. So to change that narrative feels really good. But like I said 1,000 times, this interview job's not done.
You finished top for a reason, Kayla, and a lot of that was your defensive work. And it came out
on song from the opening tip tonight?
Well, it had to be better than game one, didn't it? That was not ideal. So, yeah, I think we did a great job of rectifying that. And, I mean, they'll change some things, we'll adjust some things, and it'll be a bloody great game on Saturday, I'm sure.
Lindsay Allen, is she a rip snorter?
You bloody better believe it.
Wow.
Pardon?
Wow.
Yes, wow.
But how great is she?
Oh, LA, yeah, she's phenomenal. I've played with her for three seasons now, and she just is a phenomenal point guard, one of the best point guards I've ever played with. She reads the game so well, can score when she needs to. You know, she's just phenomenal and a great human.
Okay, you've got to get home to Melbourne. Is it a 5 a.m. flight tomorrow via Sydney?
No, we're not on that one. That was full, unfortunately. We've got a bit of a morning brunch here in Perth, and then we head home and get home pretty late. Not pretty late. I mean, for me, it's 7 o'clock, which is close to my bedtime. But because people like to remind me I'm in my 30s, so but it's close to my bedtime, 7:20 when we land. So, yeah, I'll just pick up my dogs and have a good sleep, and we'll get back to training on Friday and get ready for game three.
See you on Saturday.
See you, mate.
We're so lucky to have Kayla George in the league. She was enormous in that final quarter. She finished with 22 and 12, but went 7 and 4 with the game on the line in the last quarter. And there were so many little touches and things that she had in that final term, which really determined the outcome here. Melbourne 76, Perth 75, a game with 13 lead changes. And in the end, one foul shot which fell short from Marina Mabry means that we're talking about the result of this game as opposed to sitting here in overtime.
Oh, that foul shot, I mean, I feel for Mabry because she had the chance to win it or send it into overtime, and she ended up with 30 points. I mean, she played a really good game, and down the stretch she made some big baskets. But you know what? Give Melbourne full credit for the way they came out, the way the adjustments that they made. Lindsay Allen, 29 points.
Game three to decide the championship on Saturday. Megan Huswaite, courtside. Megan.
I'm with Lindsay Allen. You bring imports into your team to win you big finals, grand finals and championships. Lindsay Allen has helped the Boomers take it to game three. We're just saying, has it sunk in yet? It's a bit of both.
Yeah, a little bit of both like we were talking about, but just glad to survive and be able to play game three at home in front of our fans.
What does it mean to go home now and have the chance to win it? It's gone against what narratives might traditionally be. They got you in Melbourne. You've got them in Perth. You get to go home and play in front of your fans.
Yeah, it means a lot, you know, just being home, being able to sleep in our own beds, see family, friends, or just being in a comfortable environment means a lot. But, I mean, we know we're going to get Perth's best game in game three, and we're going to bring our best as well, so it should be a good game.
What do you do now in terms of recovery? Kayla was telling us how you've got to get back to Melbourne, I think via Sydney. How important is recovery and moving on to game three and not getting too caught up in tonight, even though it was incredible?
Yeah, it's super important. I mean, we're flying back tomorrow, play Saturday. So, you know, really have Friday to sort of get back into things and recover and work through some stuff and change some things if we need to. But just kind of switching our mindset is the most important thing.
There was a bit of a few words exchanged and a bit of heat there in the dying second. We can expect to see that continue in game three. It is a championship on the line.
Yeah, I think so. I think a little bit of it is just the refs trying to settle things down. But, I mean, we were fine. Perth was fine. Just competitors, like you said.
Well, we love to see it because we're going to game three. We'll see you at Parkville on Saturday. Congrats, LA.
Sounds good. Thanks, Megan.
Thank you.
She was phenomenal. Lindsay Allen had 19 in the first half and finished with 29 for the game, along with Kayla George leading the way for the Melbourne Boomers.
We were thinking of having a cruisy day.
Maybe grab a pastry and a coffee.
See some street art.
Maybe go to a museum.
Grab a gelato.
And have afternoon tea.
Any suggestions?
Moment for your next career step? Can you have a stellar career filled with passion? Yes, but it all starts with you. Get experience connected and ready with mid-year entry at the University of Canberra.
That proved to be the winning moment. Marina Mabry missing that final foul shot. She had 13 points in the final quarter alone, had 30 for the night to lead all scorers. And such is the cruel nature of sport sometimes. The final foul shot ultimately decides the game. Both teams are going to a deciding game three, but it's denied the Lynx the opportunity to try and close out in front of their home fans. What an amazing finish. A single point decides the game. The Boomers win it 76-75 in a match which had 13 lead changes, Carrie.
Yeah, look, as we said all game, it was what championship games are made of. It had everything. It had momentum swings. It was an arm wrestle. It had big players making big shots at big moments. Individual performances of Allen and Mabry. Adjustments from coaches from game one to game two. It was scintillating to watch.
Well, and I think that, we knew that Melbourne had to come up with some adjustments, and they did, and they played so much better this game. But I don't think Perth played poorly today. I think they didn't shoot as well as they could, but as we said at the beginning, they almost played a perfect game in game one, and for them to repeat that would have been a really big thing. So I think it was just a high-quality caliber game, and we can expect the same in game three.
Yeah, and you think sort of one shot here or there, and we're talking about the other team right now and celebrating a Perth championship. Here's the end of the game. So I just want to move through a few of these big moments. So Kayla George hits the bucket, which was enormous from three-point land. Put them up by four. You're thinking at that point, less than 24 on the clock. Marina Mabry says, hold the phone. Hits a three from the corner to get within one. Perth pick up another possession after some made foul shots for Kayla George. It's a three-point game with less than 10 on the clock. Mabry goes to the line to shoot three. She makes the first two. And then on the game-deciding foul shot, left one a little short. What a sequence to end the game.
Well, you wouldn't have scripted that, would you? You know, if we had started.
I almost called it, I got to say, though.
you did say overtime.
I did say overtime.
And I did say about the commentator's curse. Oh, dear. People will remember that last shot, but there's lots of shots during the game, a little missed layup here, a little missed putback or whatever,
that are a big shot from Lindsay Allen that all combine to make this final scoreline.
There's so many stars we can talk about. So Mabry has 30. Lindsay Allen in particular had 29, and she was particularly good in the first half. But you use the phrase about sort of great players make great plays. The end of the match for Kayla George, sort of forcing turnovers, pulling down rebounds, making foul shots, hitting threes. It felt like when they needed someone just to carry them across the line, it was the captain in Kayla George that got them there.
It was, as she said, a bloody rip snorter. and she did that, as you say, Corbin, down the stretch. I mean, you know, it was a captain's knock. She came up with big shots when they needed it. She didn't go shy on that three-point shot. Here she is coming up with the steal. You called it. That was the captain's knock down the stretch at both ends of the floor.
And I give her full credit because she didn't have a good game one. She, you know, just really didn't have an impact at all. And so to come out with that different mindset and be confident in what she could do and the shots that she could take is a real credit to her. And you know, she's going to have to do that again and repeat it in. And we have to remember, she was playing with four fouls there for a while. And Perth were really smart and identified that and said, let's go at her. And so, you know, she had to play with that, and she was able to get that done.
A guy named Adam Mackay is a filmmaker. He's been following the Melbourne Boomers throughout the season and sort of documenting every single piece of this step. I can't wait to see the part of the show which documents tonight's performance in particular. And I've been lucky enough to see a few excerpts from it already. And Kayla George, her leadership in particular, she's a special woman, and we're lucky to have her in this competition. We saw it on display tonight. Lindsay Allen, so one of the two imports. And it feels like whenever you have...
Impressive.
There's a lot of similarity, sorry, Laurie, between these two teams. So only won one championship ever. Tom Maher's the championship winning coach on both occasions, both in drought. So the Boomers haven't won one for 10 years. Perth, it's much longer than that, in 30 years. We're going to game three now, a deciding game, which feels fitting to decide the championship on Saturday. You see it there. It starts at 5 p.m. rather, Australian Eastern Standard Time. So local time for the game in Melbourne, 3 p.m. for those of you out on the west coast of Australia. Who deserves favouritism, Laurie Chiswick, for Game 3 coming up on Saturday?
Well, can I just say, seeing as, you know, you said you called overtime, and last game you said you picked Perth, I would just like to say, before the season even started, I had Melbourne as my champions, but I did put a little asterisk by it and say, if Perth got Sammy Whitcomb, they would be right up there in the final too. So I just thought I'd throw that in right now.
And who wins on Saturday then?
Oh, I'm not good. I can't pick.
Carrie, I mean, it's so unusual. We've never seen a team come back from 1-0 down in a best of three series. Small sample size. There's only been, I think this is only the sixth time we've had a best of three to decide the championship. So you would have history being created if the Boomers are able to do it. But and now we've got the unusual quirk that the two games have been won by the road team.
Yeah, look, it comes back to the things we said earlier. You know, it's about pressure. It's about possession and D. And I think, you know, which team can handle the pressure of being in that game three and with it all on the line?
I'll see you there, Laurie. Carrie, great to work with you as always. We got the conclusion that feels fitting of the season. It is a game to decide the WNBL Championship. 40 minutes to prove who gets to go home with the trophy. Thanks to our entire crew working behind the scenes, to Megan Huswaite courtside on behalf of Carrie Graff, Laurie Chiswick. I'm Corbin Middlemass signing off. The Bendat Basketball Centre, what a thrilling conclusion. The Boomers by a point, we're off to game three on Saturday. See you then.